Hello and welcome back to another video with It's Dr. Dan, and what we are going to be looking at today is electromagnetic radiation. We are going to be trying to understand the basic concepts of the wave, how this can carry energy that will excite different atoms and be able to promote electrons up and down energy levels, which will help us be able to see how these different elements behave when they're excited. It also is how energy gets transported in a lot of different chemical reactions as well when they get heated up and cool down. So what exactly are we going to be looking at as we're moving through this? Right, the first thing you're going to see is like, oh, those look really cool. These are all kinds of different lights. And that's the thing, right? They're all different fluorescent processes. What is this? It's all emission or phosphorescence, fluorescence. How can radiation be seen and observed, right? These are all visible forms of light that are being given off that can be observed via the eyes. What's causing that? Well, it's all about the relaxation of electrons. So when an electron gets excited, meaning it absorbed a bunch of energy, it's kind of vibrating around, and then it goes up to a higher energy level. Now, when it comes back down, it can emit light in order to relax. So it's how it de-stresses itself. So all these are how electrons can de-stress, and we can see all kinds of cool effects as a result, meaning that light and matter are intimately connected. All these are made of matter, and they all emit light, so they're related. So this was a problem that really tried and baffled the physics community for centuries, is how they could describe this, because essentially, around the year 1899, around 1900, physics was able to explain everything. They thought they had it all figured out. But the thing was, is one thing that it could not explain was how light and matter interacted when it came down to the atomic level. Everything broke. And that's what we're going to be trying to look at in this video and trying to understand is what the nature of light is all about. Let's take a look as we move forward. Comes down from is the nature of light is all about electromagnetic radiation. Now that word electro, that means that there's an electric field, which is a region of space that's electrically charged, and then there's a magnetic field where we have magnetic forces, meaning that particles that are subatomic particles that have positive and negative charges, they're going to be affected by these. Just like what we've seen, how they discovered all the different atomic particles or all the different subatomic particles, electromagnetic radiation can affect all these different things. So with electromagnetic radiation, how exactly does it work? Well, it's all about oscillating motion. If you look really closely, you can see that the waves here, there's two of them that are perpendicular, like a cross, and you see that they're both oscillating towards you, right? So the red one up there is essentially showing the magnetic field, and the blue one is showing the electric field. They are perpendicular and they're both oscillating extremely fast when it's real time. Now, how fast are we talking? All electromagnetic radiation, it moves at the speed of light, which is 2.998 times 10 to the 8th power meters per second. So we are talking very, very quick and very, very fast as these are all moving. So when these are moving, we got to understand exactly how does the anatomy of the wave look and how can we represent it. So the first thing is seeing that, okay, every wave, it's this oscillating motion, and we can label all those different individual parts that we have. Right, we can show that we have the top portion, the bottom. We can actually be able to kind of really look at all the different parts here. So if I have the anatomy of the wave, notice how the tops are all crests. The bottoms are what we call troughs, so the lowest portions of these. But the most important part is the distance between the two peaks. So we have the distance between these two. This is referred to as a wavelength, which uses the symbol lambda to illustrate that difference. Now, one of the things that I kind of, as I was showing before, but it was different on my slides versus my tablet, is how can we describe how these waves are moving? So up here, I found a GIF of traditional waves and light waves. The one above is essentially how you picture waves if you go to the beach, right? Waves are oscillating, they're coming at you. You can stand in the water and you'll keep getting hit by that top part of that wave. So the top part, that is your crest. So all the ones that are kind of going up here, I know it's pausing, are your crest at the top portion. That's the part that's knocking you back. There's a ton of energy that's associated with that point as it hits you. Now, there's a distance between those crests, and the other portion is all about how often does that crest hit you, right? So as it's oscillating, you're also going to have a frequency of how often that is hitting you as well. So the speed of light is always equal, is essentially related to the wavelength and the frequency of how often it's hitting. Let's take a look a little bit farther about how this works and how we can try to understand this idea of frequency. So frequency is essentially, we represent this by the Greek letter nu, which looks like, it looks very similar to a V, but it's a little tiny bit different. So just to kind of illustrate that, to write it here, essentially, if I would kind of put a little curve on the V here, this is a nu. All right. So there's it looks slightly different. I know it's subtle and you're like, it looks the same, but I promise you it's different. So with that frequency, that's essentially an inverse seconds, because we're curious about how often it's hitting the starting point. So imagine you standing at the beach, standing in the middle of the water. How often are the waves hitting you? So one way to kind of think about it is, as we're kind of moving forward, is we'll try to talk about the relationships, and I'll use some analogies to try to make that make sense. So with waves, right, they can also come in different forms. Is how strong are they? How are the wavelengths being affected? Few things is like how dim or how bright it is. Remember, we're talking about light. So if you have like a dimmer switch at home, making your lights really, really bright or really, really dim, essentially the wave will grow or shrink in height. So if it's a very, very bright light, it's going to have a very tall wave, versus if it's very dim, it's going to be very short. So this is the amplitude, or how strong or how big it is. We also have wavelengths can change. Now, based on the size of the wave, whether it's really short or if it's really long, can change the color that you perceive as well within the visible portion of the spectrum. So this is also something that we're going to be discussing quite a bit as well. So now, one of the things about, as we kind of go through this, we need to be able to understand what the relationship is between wavelength and frequency. How can we show that? Well, it's actually a little bit simpler, or sort of simple, how to explain it. So if you're standing at the beach and you have a wave hitting you over time, well, that wave has a very specific wavelength, and it is essentially going to be hitting you at a very specific frequency. What exactly are those units behind those? Well, if you remember, wavelength is a distance, right? It's all about, if I have a wave, is how far essentially the tops of the different waves are from each other, right? So if I kind of draw that wave again and it keeps going, it's all about how far. So that's meters. Now, the nu, or the invert, or the frequency, is inverse seconds. So what happens if I were to times those two? That's going to be meters per second. But what was meters per second? That was your speed of light. So what does that tell you about these two things? Is what's important is there's a relationship here. And essentially, as the wavelength increases, the frequency will decrease, or vice versa. Okay. Now, how can I try to explain that relationship? So let's go back to the beach example, probably where a lot of us rather be rather than listening to this. But how would we describe it? Well, if you're standing at the beach, you have waves hitting you at such a frequency. Now, compare that to, let's say, if there was a hurricane or a storm. how often do you think those waves would be hitting you? They'd be hitting you at a very, very fast rate, right? But essentially the distance between those waves would be very, very short. So the waves up here could be like a very calm day versus if it's a hurricane, you'll see that they are, or a storm, the waves would be a lot closer together, but the frequency is a lot greater. So notice how the frequency, the wavelength is lower, but the frequency increases. Whereas here, the wavelength increases and the frequency decreases. There's a relationship for how often is it going to be hitting you as the person standing on the beach. Okay, so how often will that be hitting you as it's traveling towards you? Okay, that's kind of the idea. All right, let's take a look a little bit more about this type of how light and waves behave. So we have the wavelengths of these, and the thing is we measure them in meters. Now the range of this can vary immensely. It goes from everywhere from 10 to the negative 15 meters, which is around a femtometer, to all the way down to 10 to the 5, which is more around maybe like a little over kilometers or even close to megameters, so very, very large. Now, these waves, they are separated into different regions. So you have radio waves, so what you listen to possibly in your car, microwaves, how you heat up food, infrared, if you kind of have a heat lamp or even just like an infrared like heater at home, ultraviolet from what the sun emits, x-rays for what we use in the medical field, and gamma rays what we use for chemotherapy. We have many different kinds of radiation, and they all spread at these different areas. Now, with that being said, there is a relationship here. So the first thing is, where does the visible come in? The visible is that tiny little rainbow strip that's right there in the middle of this slide, right? So it's right between infrared and ultraviolet. It's a very slim region between 400 nanometers and 750 nanometers. So 10 to the negative 9 meters. We only see a very little, or 10 to the negative 7, 10 to the negative 8 meters. We only see a very, very tiny region of that. So the thing about this is there's a relationship as well, is that the smaller the wavelength, so going all the way to, let's say, gamma rays, the higher the energy, so the more powerful it is. So very high frequencies have very high energy. So gamma and x-rays are things that can destroy things versus radio waves. They don't interact with anything. They're too low in energy. This is why gamma rays are something that when astronauts go into space, they have to wear all this space protection, not just for the oxygen, but to protect them from radiation as well, because ups in space, there's only gamma rays up there mainly, are the biggest threat. Or when we're trying to irradiate or try to irradiate someone with cancer, we'll generally use small dosages of gamma rays to try to target cancer cells to destroy that. So versus a radio wave, it's something that just carries sound and noise and something that won't be anything that could be problematic. So there are relationships there which are very, very important. Moving forward though, so we have that relationship. We also have energy. So I mentioned earlier that every single wave carries energy. How does it do that? Well, this is where it can get a little complicated, but being this is just an introductory video, electromagnetic radiation or waves have a wave-particle duality to them, meaning that they move as waves, but they are also particles as well. So these particles, they carry energy. These particles are known as photons. You probably have heard of the word photon before. Maybe if you've ever seen Star Trek, the word photon torpedo is used quite often in that show. It's also used in all kinds of different science shows as well. So essentially, energy is equal to H times the frequency. H is a constant, which you can find on your handouts, which is 6.626 times 10 to the negative 34. You times that by the frequency, you will get your energy in joules, which is just the letter J for the unit. So not like the vape pen, but joule, J-O-U-L-E-S is how you spell that, which will allow you to be able to describe and to derive. This can also be directly related to wavelength as well. So if you know that C is equal to lambda nu, we could also show that we can rearrange both of these formulas to show that energy is equal to h times speed of light divided by lambda as well. It's all related to each other. So all three of these formulas are formulas I'd write down in your notebook so that way you have them for yourself when you're trying to work up and use these. And it's just a plug and play equation. You put in your frequency, you put in your wavelength, you can get your energy and calculate all the different values. Now, just to summarize all that, the big thing is that wavelength, frequency are interrelatable, right? So it's one goes up, the other one goes down. Amplitude is just how big the wave is, right? So how intense is it? And now being that we have that inverse relationship between wavelength and frequency, is also related to the energy as well, and that all waves move at the speed of light. Okay. So that is really some of the basic ideas. And we're going to be seeing a lot of this kind of moving forward and how this works. Now, why is it that we're talking about this? Why do we need to know? Well, it has to do with quantum mechanics, which when you hear that, you're like, oh my God, what did I sign up for? What am I trying to learn here? In this video into two parts, so please look out for that part two. The whole idea here is I want to be able to separate the quantum mechanics portion of this video, being that it goes through the idea that we need to, that all electrons, they need to go in their own specific energy levels, which will eventually go into their own individual orbitals. So this is a method for us to be able to see that all electrons require a certain amount of energy to excite them, which will put them in their own little, essentially filing organization, which is known as electron configuration. So in the follow-up video, take a look out for that. It's going to be all on how quantum really, the basic idea of how quantum works in a 50-minute video. So thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you all later. Bye now.